Amen. Amen. I'm glad you're here. We're in the final installment of our extraordinary series, and you got to believe this. This is the reason why we're doing the series. You got to believe that extraordinary relationships are possible. Like, you can have great relationships. How many believe that you can have a great marriage? You can have a great relationship in every sphere that you are in. You can have great relationships in your career field, in your employment field, in your family. You can have great relationships. But what we're seeing throughout this series is that although it's possible, they're just not probable. There's just not a lot of great relationships as we kind of look into even our spheres. We're like, well, it's not so much. It's not very extraordinary. And so we're looking like, okay, how do we shift our relationships from the ordinary of what maybe they are, of what those coworker relationships are, what the relationships in our family or our marriages, or even with our kids or our in-laws or outlaws or whatever. How do we move it from ordinary to extraordinary? And we've been dissecting a few different levels of like relationship, and what we're today, I'd like to focus on communication. The title of the message today is Extraordinary Communication. And this is another area where we have just done it the world's way. What we're doing in this series is we're kind of drawing a line and saying, look, this is the world's way of doing it. It's ordinary. And here's God's way of doing it that is extraordinary. And the way that we are communicating, especially to the people that we love the most, we tend to hurt the most. Isn't that true? And our words can become so idle, so flippant, so just hurtful. In every sphere, you look at culture today, and the world's way of communicating today, as far as you look at our marriages and relationships, you look at some reality TV shows, you look at politics and how ugly it is, the way, the vile, the vulgar, the vicious nature of our communication. You go on social media and you try to comment on a thread and share your mind about politics. Don't do that. They will eat you up. They will annihilate you. And it's because a lot of ways we've dehumanized people in the process. And that's why we're able to annihilate them and to trash them and to hurt them with our words the way we do, is because we've kind of dehumanized them, because that's not really a person, that's a profile. Just a profile, and I can jack them up, right? So to to illustrate this, I was on the freeway in traffic, and I'm trying to get off the freeway. I'm trying to get an exit, but it was like tons of people already there, and I'm in the wrong lane. But I'm like, I'm trying to get over, and I'm trying to find somebody's eyes, right? Because if you can get their eyes, you can get a little pity, like, oh. And you can get maybe a little pity in, and that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying, if I can get their eyes, but nobody, everyone's like, no, no. They know I'm there. They just, nope, I'm not letting you into my world. No, 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 no. And I'm like, come on, somebody help me out. Exit's coming. And I catch eyes with what I imagine is the daughter of the mom who's driving. And she's in the passenger seat, and we catch eyes, and I give her the... And so it's like, I'm endearing, like, come on, help me out, girl. And we make a connection there, with our eyes locked, and she felt my pain. And so she taps her mom, mom, let... And I see her, and the mom goes, ah. So this girl, this godly, precious child of God. What happened in that moment is I became a person to her. But before that, I was just a car. And so it's really easy to be hurtful and ugly and vicious when you take the human element out of it, when you're just a party. You're just liberal. You're just alt-right. You're just a car, you're just a profile, you're just, and we can be so hurtful when you dehumanize the people in the process. So just like every week we've done, we're gonna draw the line, but I'd like to read our theme verse first. Now with the context of today's topic of extraordinary communication, let's read that with that filter and with that context of communication in our relationships. Romans chapter 12 says, don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world. Okay, so the world, listen, the world has a way of communicating. The world has a way, and it's ordinary. It's all too ordinary, and we see it. The dysfunctional, the hateful, the hurtful ordinary communication. Here again is Paul saying, don't copy the behavior and the customs of the world, but let God transform you. And this is kind of foundational to the series. If you're new to us, this idea of transformation is absolutely essential for us to have extraordinary anything, okay? Like, because I'm so glad, and aren't you glad with me, that we do not serve a God that goes, hey, you need to go do this and do that and do this and do that. Go do the relationships better. Go communicate better. That's not what God does. That's not what He's about. What God does is He changes your heart. God has a relationship with you. He changes you from the inside out, so that what the fruit of now my life is extraordinary, because God has touched me. God has changed me. So the result or the solution now to our ordinary life, the solution to our ordinary relationships, doing it the world's way, the solution to our ordinary communication is let God transform you into a brand new person by changing the way you think. See, and that's again what I love to do. I can't change anybody, but what I can do is lead you to the well of water. I can give you the thoughts of God's Word, and it's only the Holy Spirit Himself who can actually change you. So today, again, I'm going to try to bring you some new thoughts, some God-honoring, some principles of God's Word that it can shift and change your mind. Then when that happens, He says, then you're going to know. You're going to learn to know God's will for you. So you're going to learn to know. You're going to have God's will for your marriage. You're going to in every area of your relationships, your dating, your friends, your workplaces, God has a will for you, and it is good, pleasing, and perfect. And that's not a fantasy. That is possible. Come on, how many believe you can have a good marriage? Come on. That you can have pleasing children. That you can have a pleasant workplace environment. Like, you can. In Jesus' name, you can. I'm going to show you how, because there is so much power in your words. There is so much power. And what I hope to do today, above all else, I really hope to bring weight to your words. I hope today that you would understand the weight, the value, the heaviness that your communication and that your words have. There is so much power in our words, in our communication. And I know a lot of us are probably right now even thinking of maybe the things that we said that we shouldn't have said. Just know, please, that the blood of Jesus can cover you, cleanse you of all unrighteousness. So I know we all have spoken idly and spoken hurtfully at times, but don't worry. Jesus Christ can cover and cleanse. But you know what? We got to change. Come on, we can't continue to put our foot in our mouth and hurt the people we love the most. We can't continue to do ordinary communication. We need God to change us so we can have extraordinary communication. Okay, so something needs to change. We need to change. God, please change me. So here's what we're going to do. We need to look at communication, get some understanding of communication. What is, again, just like we've done throughout these last 3 weeks, ordinary communication. This is the way that the world does it, and here's God's way. And then at the end of the message, I want to share with you some extraordinary tools of communication that can really empower all of your relationships if you do it God's way. But first, let's increase our understanding in this topic of communication. There's 4 levels of communication. If you're taking notes, write these down with me. I didn't come up with these. These are like very smart people with lots of letters after their names that came up with this. But I want to share with you. I want to increase your understanding in this area. So number one, the first level of communication is surface communication. Those are just the cliche communication. That is, hey, how you doing? Oh, I'm fine, thank you. We're not really looking or intending to engage in a conversation. Hey, how you doing? God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. And there's no really intention of, sometimes we even just give a nod. Hey, how you doing? And we just nod. It's just, we don't even communicate back. It's just a little, and we go on our way. That's surface level communication. The second level goes a little bit deeper, and it's simply general information. General information. So some of you, your homes and your marriages, this is where you are at right here. You're just passing along information. Hey, Johnny has a test tomorrow. Make sure he studies. Hey, I'm going to be a little late. I'm going to go work out at the gym, you know, after work, so I'm going to be a little late. You're just passing along information, but we're really not going any deeper than that. Real communication, as you can see, kind of looking forward in the outline, has to go to a deeper level. It has to go deeper. In fact, men, I'm going to help you out, men in this room. The 4 most romantic words your wife will ever hear, that you could ever speak to your wife. I'm going to help you out. I hope you take these notes. These are the four most romantic words your wife will ever hear. Here it is. Write it down. And then what happened? I'm telling you, when she passes out, pick her up and continue that conversation. My wife is always amazed, shocked when I want to have more information. You know, it's like, oh, you're into this conversation. I was going to give you the information anyway, but this is nice, right? I was going to keep talking anyway, but it's nice to know you're with me still. So that's, and then when, okay, here's, it's got to go deeper. Number three, write this down, deep feelings. Deep feelings. Because people have feelings, and here's what I've learned about feelings. And that is, feelings aren't always right, but they're always real. Feelings aren't always right. Our feelings aren't always right, but they're always real. And so a lot of times you can have feelings, and even the person that's having the feelings knows it's wrong, but it's still real to them. Have you ever been in that situation? It's real. And a lot of us, we don't have a safe place to express those feelings we have because we're going to get correction if I speak this to the person I love. If I speak this, I'm going to get corrected. If that sounds like just all too familiar for you, you should go listen to the last week's message, Extraordinary Conflict. Check out Extraordinary Conflict a couple weeks ago. When that happens, though, it makes me, hey, when you do that, when this happens and that happens, it makes me feel like this. This is the way I feel. And you can question my facts, but you can't question my feelings. Those are real to me. So we need to get to a place where it's safe to express our feelings with the people that we love. It should be safe to express those feelings with the people that we love. And then the ultimate level of communication, really, that a lot of relationships, even a lot of marriages, don't live here at this deepest level of communication. And that is, write this down, is deepest needs. Our deep needs. Let me tell you what I need. Let me speak to marriages here. This will apply to all your relationships that are important to you, but the best marriages is where you have an understanding of your spouse's deepest needs. Those are the best marriages. So, and honestly, I could say that more don't know than do know. I know from experience, doing years of marriage counseling, I'd be counseling couples, and I would tell the man, write down five things. I give him this project. You write down five things, the deepest needs that you can fulfill in your wife. Write them down. You write them down, and then why? You write down five of the deepest needs that you can fulfill in your husband. And they would write those things down, and we'd kind of compare, and it would, every time, it would not match up. Because there wasn't deep communication of our deep feelings and our deep needs. That's why they're in my office anyway, because they're not connecting at a deep level. We need to get to a place where we're communicating at the deepest level, which is, let me tell you what's going on in my life and how you can meet that need. And the best marriages are where I'm serving your need, you're serving my need, and together our needs are met. That's the best marriages. It's not where I'm going to take care of me, and you're going to take care of you. No, the best marriages, I'm going to take care of what you need, you're going to take care of what I need, and together we're going to have our needs met from one another. And you got to be careful here, you guys, because God created you for community. Listen, God created you to go deep. Even some of you guys in here, or even girls, it's tough for you to go to this deep level of communication and friendship and community with people. God created you to go deep, and you're going to go deep one way or the other. It's going to be deep the world's way, or it's going to be deep God's way. And I'm telling you, so this isn't part of the message, but if you want to draw a line at number two, you should draw a line like right there underneath number two, because at that point of after general information, you were created to go deep. You're going to create a deep connection with the people around you. It's either going to be God's way or the world's way. So here it is. Please listen. It's so important. Just give me a minute, and then we're going to get back on topic. You're going to either express your deep feelings and needs. You're going to either share your deep feelings and needs, or you're going to share somebody else's deep feelings and needs. So because I don't want to share my feelings, and I'm afraid to share, and I'm insecure about my feelings and my needs, I'm going to judge somebody else's feelings. I'm going to judge their motives. I'm going to judge their character. I'm going to judge their heart. I'm going to judge, they're fake. Oh, yeah, they're fake. So we put people around us. Now everyone around us is is people that are negative and critical and gossiping, and we're creating deep connections. It's called pseudo-community. It's not a real community. It's a pseudo-community. It's not founded upon things that are real, on things that are factual, on things that are the things of God. So they get together and gossip and talk and criticize, and then they separate, and then they gossip and talk and criticize about each other. Because God created you to go deep. And if you're not going to talk about your own feelings and needs, you're going to talk about theirs. Oh, they're fake, they're phony, this and that. And that you will. I'm telling you, if you're not doing it, you're going to do that. You're going to do it the world's way. Or deep needs. How many of you ever work with someone that they try to tell you how to do your job before they even do theirs? Here's what you need to do. Here's what you need to do. That's what they say. This is what you need to do. This is what you need to do. You should do this. You should. And they're not even doing their own job. Come on, man. Like, you got, or this is what you need to do in your marriage, and they're on their third marriage. This is what you need to do. This is, this is what my business should do. They should do it this way. This is what the church should do. Oh, the church should do, the church, and they got all the answers. Well, what are you doing? Come on now. Okay, so this, you got to be careful that you are going to go deep. You're either going to allow people to get in touch with your feelings and your needs, or you're gonna get in other people's business and talk about their feelings and their needs. Extraordinary communication. You're either going to do it God's way, or you're going to do it the world's way. So what do we do about that? There's some barriers, obviously, to kind of doing it God's way. There's barriers that every one of us kind of come up against to having this kind of communication in our life, and this extraordinary God-honoring communication. And there is these two researchers, Dr. Markman and Dr. Stanley, that came up with these four barriers. Christian man, they studied for 20 years, and they came up with these four barriers of communication. They said these are the four reasons, the four primary reasons of divorce. Like, this is involved, these four things. So write these down, because there's some barriers that we need to address. Number one, that first barrier is withdrawal. Because the tendency is just to shut the whole thing down, right? That's it, I've had enough, last word, final word, and we just... And so we get frustrated with the process of communication, and we just kind of end it. We stop it. Or sometimes we even, you know, physically withdraw. So you do the old silent treatment, right? Every marriage has done the silent treatment in here. Come on, Veronica and I have done the silent treatment. If you've ever done the silent treatment, you can't even touch the other person, can you? You're in the bed, and you're like the blanket. Because if your heel even touches me, I lose. I can't. Don't touch me. So... I read this story of this guy and this man and wife. They're having a fight. They're doing the silent treatment, and they're mad at each other. And he doesn't want to lose, but he has to get up really early for a flight, a 5 a.m. flight. And he knows that she's up early for her job anyway. So he didn't want to talk to her though and say, hey, help me out, wake me up. So he just writes a note, puts it on the sink where the toothpaste and toothbrushes are, and he's like, I'm not going to lose this argument. I'm just going to write her a note. When she gets up, he says, wake me up for my 5 a.m. flight, please, and puts that, and he goes to bed. He wakes up at 7 a.m., and he's like, he missed his flight. He starts freaking out. He looks at the nightstand next to him, and it's a little note from his wife saying, wake up, it's 5 a.m. Men, let me tell you, you are ill-equipped to win that battle. I'm trying, don't even go there, okay? Here's the second level. The second level after that is called escalation. You guys know what escalation is. It starts here, and then I up you, and then she ups me, and then up and up, and it just escalates out of control. We talked about this in that extraordinary conflict message there. This is where now, though, your tempers are flaring, you're speaking loudly to each other, which, by the way, doesn't work. Even if you do get your way, it doesn't work. It's, if the heart doesn't receive it, you still lose. Escalation doesn't work. And then it gets to this very dangerous level, where your words get involved to hurt people or to put them down, and they called it belittling, where you start to belittle that person because because I'm not taking the high road, I'm not gonna elevate my character, and because I am already I need to push you down and make you feel low. I need to put you lower than me because I can't do the work myself of building up my character. I need to put you lower, so because I can't lift myself up, you're going underneath me. And you start belittling people and hurting them and casting shade on them. And that's why people are so stinking critical. I'm telling you, it's actually an insecurity issue, why people are critical. They're insecure. Insecure people don't raise their character. They throw shade on everybody else's to make themselves look better. That's what insecure people do. They belittle others. And that's why people are so critical. It's out of control in our world today, in politics and social media, even in relationships and marriages, and it's even in churches. There was this couple that was driving down the road, and they were in just this kind of escalated argument. And it was in the countryside, and they were driving past the farm, and there was sheep and, you know, goats and pigs and farm animals and stuff like that. And he thought cows, and he thought, you know, he thought of a little quip just to put down his wife. And so he's driving. He's like, "Hey, check it out, relatives of yours?" And she, and she said, "Yes, they are in-laws." So, like I said, man, you're not going to win that battle. You're just ill-equipped, dude. The fourth one is very dangerous, because now, listen, now it becomes demonic. And I don't want to kind of overemphasize this, but I want to bring the weight that is necessary to this level. Your words can become demonic, meaning that the devil is actually involved in the process. When it turns to number four, false belief. False belief. John chapter 8, not in your notes, but it says that the devil is a liar. And he's the father of all lies. And so what the devil does to actually, you know, he tries to destroy you and your relationships, all the relationships that matter most, the way he tries to destroy it is by telling lies. He's trying to lie, and he's trying to divide. And when it doesn't take that proper path of communication, it gets to this place where you are creating things that didn't even happen. You're creating motives and intentions and realities that aren't even there. They're false realities that you've created and fabricated by your own communication because you took the wrong path, because you didn't do it God's way. And now the people that were supposed to be, man, there in your life to lift you up and to sharpen you and to encourage you and to love you, you now look at them with toxic eyes because of the words that you've spoken and the words that you've received against your husband, against your wife, against your leaders, against the people you're doing life with. It's toxic now, and the devil is involved in that communication process. It has become demonic. So what do you do about all that? If this has become ordinary to us, well, we got to take an extraordinary approach. And Jesus was not silent on this topic of the words that we use. He was not silent. The Bible is not silent on the topic of the words and the power of the words. There's tons of Proverbs that talk about the power of your words. We're going to read some of those today. But what I am hoping to do today is just add some weight. Really, one of the most concerning statements that Jesus made to people about this topic was, about any topic really, was when he talked about blaspheming the Holy Spirit. That was one of the most radical things he said. It was, hey, if you blaspheme the Holy Spirit, he said, this is the only sin that's not going to be forgiven and pardoned, is blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And every now and then I talk to people, I want to put you at ease here. Some people are like, oh, if I blaspheme the Holy Spirit, listen, you would not be sitting in this room today if you blaspheme the Holy Spirit. You would be so reprobate of mind, so your heart would be so far away from God. I'm telling you, you have not blasphemed the Holy Spirit. But what this does say to us is that the greatest sin that can ever be committed, according to what Jesus is saying and the Word is saying, the greatest sin that could ever be committed is the sin of spoken word. It's not an action you would do to someone. It's not, you know, the way I would even treat somebody. It's not like murder or adultery or all the, no. According to God, the greatest sin that you could ever commit is words that you would speak out of your mouth. But then right after talking about the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit and that it wouldn't be forgiven, he goes on to say, right after talking about that, Jesus said, and every one of you is going to give an account to God for every idle word that is spoken out of your mouth. To which some people say, well, are you kidding me, Pastor? There's going to come a day where I'm going to stand before God and he's going to have this list of things, of everything I've ever said? Yes. Yes. Unless you let Jesus cleanse and purify you. The Holy Spirit is the great eraser. He cleanses and purifies our iniquities, our unrighteousness, and totally wipes them out. Yeah, unless we get it. But so what is Jesus doing here? Jesus, he knows that. He came to give this gospel of freedom and grace and forgiveness. So what is he saying? Why is he even saying this, that you're going to give an account of your words? Because he's trying to add weight to your words, that your words are powerful, that your words are meaningful, and that you're being so idle, you're being so flippant, and that he's trying to just add weight so that they would feel, wow, there is power. I got to be careful. There is power in my words. And I hope you receive that today. I hope that you leave here with that one thought, is that your words are powerful. They're powerful. This is Matthew chapter 12, that same, it's in the Message translation. Beautiful. I love the way it translates this verse in the Message. Jesus says, let me tell you something. Every one of these careless words is going to come back to haunt you. I'll stop right there. Let me explain that. That means that every time you speak, it's like a seed that is planted in the ground. And it germinates. Starts to germinate. And it produces fruit. All throughout Scripture, it gives the same analogy of the word becoming seed. There will be a time, he says, notice this capitalized, this actual day. There will be a day of reckoning. That's the judgment day. That's the day of an actual judgment before God where you'll have to give an account. There'll be a day of reckoning. Words are powerful. Man, I hope you... Words are powerful. Take them seriously. Words can either be your salvation or your damnation. You're looking at a guy right now that is a product of the words that have been spoken over him and to him. I'm looking out here on an audience of people who are the product. You are the sum total of the words, the seeds that were planted into your life. And some of you that are here today, you're very fortunate and blessed. Maybe you had parents that spoke those words of life over you. They planted seeds of life and they spoke that into you. Maybe you had great teachers, great pastors, great support, great network. And you're the product of that. There are some of you here today that did not have the benefit of having those words spoken over you, kind of like me. That you had words of hate, of anger, words that try to humiliate you and cast you down to make other people feel better. Maybe that was your experience. And like me, maybe the fruit now, the product that produced in your life became a reflection of those words. Let me tell you something. If that's you, please listen, because there is a solution. What you need to do is get into the Word of God. And you let the Word of God become the Word of truth for you. You hold on to that reality. You let it wash over you that's the Word that I'm letting germinate. That's the Word that I'm planting in my heart. That's the Word I'm holding on to. I'm holding your words in my heart, God, not every evil word that's spoken over me. And I'm telling you, it will produce fruit in your life. It'll produce fruit. Words produce fruit. There is power in your words. With your words, you create the world around you. I'm really trying to let you feel the gravity around this, you guys. The world around you is created by the words you are speaking. Some of you don't like your marriage. You don't like your kids or how they're... You don't like your job. You don't like... It's just, man... And could it possibly be that the reason why they are like that is because the words you're speaking into them? Could it be that the words that we're speaking are seeds that are producing fruit in our relationships? Now, instead of focusing on all the negative, and there's a lot for us to talk about in this topic that's very negative, I've learned that the best way to train people is not to expose all the negative, but to actually show them what God's will is. But to actually show them what they could do. And the best way for you to solve your mouth problem, if you got a communication problem, you got a gossip problem, you got a negativity, you got a critical, you got a problem speaking down and speaking out, the best way to solve that is just to begin to speak words of life. It's just to speak the words that God tells you to speak. Replace those things with the right words you're supposed to speak, and you'll be so surprised on how that'll just heal and solve your ordinary communication problems. And it'll shift it from ordinary to extraordinary. I found this great quote from the Irish playwright George Bernard Shaw. It says that the single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that it has taken place. Because some people think, oh, is this necessary? It doesn't really matter. Oh, yes, it does. And if there is a word that you ought to write down in your notes somewhere, it is intentional. Man, I want us to be so much more intentional on the words that we are speaking in our life, in our marriages, in our relationships. Be so much more intentional in how we're using those. So I'm not going to have to focus on all the bad stuff. It's just, I just got to focus on the good stuff I want to speak. And you're going to be surprised how that's going to help solve this communication problem that we're having. I want to give you seven types of communication from God's Word. I'm telling you, if you apply these to your life, if you just start communicating these things that God tells us to speak and to communicate, if you start communicating God's way, it will change your life. I'm telling you, I'll show you why. Here, write these down. You can apply these today. Number one, this is what we're going to do. We're going to start praising people. Praise. Yeah, we're going to praise people, not the kind of praise that we give God. Only He alone is worthy of that kind of praise. But praise means that I'm going to find your qualities and I'm going to focus on them. I'm going to highlight them. I'm going to fix my mouth on, let me tell you what I see in you. Let me tell you the good I see in you. I'm not going to just look for the negative and look for the things that are wrong with you and look where we need to fix things. No, I'm going to highlight the positive in these relationships. In every sphere, I'm going to highlight the positive in my marriage. I'm going to highlight the positive in my church. I'm going to highlight the positive in my kids. I'm going to praise. I'm going to let that come forth. I'm going to highlight those things that are good. Proverbs 25:11 says, a word aptly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver. A silver bowl with solid gold apples. That means we're to speak beautiful words and favorable words, valuable words, beautiful and valuable words. I want you to think about that. Adding value to people. Speaking words that add value. My kids, every time you guys, I the kids either leave home or I drop them off in their car, I speak into their life. I say, you're a leader, not a follower. Go be a leader today. You're a champion. You're a world changer. Go change the world. I tell them those things. I speak that.